कैन वी थिंक ऑफ औरंगजेब हु री इम्पोज जजिया ऑन द नॉन मुस्लिम्स. औरंगजेब, यस, अ मुगल एम्परर whom we consider to be a great orthodox. Can we imagine that when he came to know that the money coming from the trade from the Arabian countries, from the Ottoman kingdoms, the money that was sent to the officials and to the workers at Makkah and Medina, when Aurangzeb saw that there is a miscondition, that misproportionate thing going on that is not acceptable, he said that India is as well the house of a God as we have Makkah and Medina. Yes, we have to believe it because it is written in the records of the Mughal history of that time. Hello students, we are at the end of this chapter. The longest chapter and most scoring and maximum question comes in board examination from this chapter. We did the titles yesterday that most of the Mughal emperors, they obtained, they assumed heavy sounding titles. Heavy sounding titles means those titles which made them world famous. Shah Jahan, Jahangir, the titles that told the people that they are the world's Caesars. That is, they have seized the world. So all these titles they had observed. Now today we will talk about Kandahar, about the Safavids and Kandahar. As we claimed that Kashmir is ours, Kashmir belonged to Indians, similarly the Iranians, they considered Kandahar as their own territory. And this Hindu Kush mountain, Afghanistan, this had been a main thing of contention, a main thing of conflict between the Mughals and the Safavids. Although there were diplomatic relations, we know that when Humayun was defeated by Sher Shah Suri, he took refuge with the Safavids. So there were diplomatic relations, but there was political and diplomatic relations between the Mughals, between Iranians and Turan. But even then, Kandahar, or you can say Afghanistan, was a bone of contention between them. They were struggling for that. Because if any foreigner, if any invader wanted to enter India, and in North India, it was necessary to cross the Hindu Kush, to cross Afghanistan, which is a landlocked area. There is no sea route, there is no port nearby. So if anyone wanted to enter our frontiers and enter into the North India, they have to cross Hindu Kush. And Afghanistan is the area which separated the areas of Central Asia and Iran. So this was an area of strategic importance, and we all know that Akbar conquered the areas up to Hindu Kush. So the control of the frontiers were defined by the Hindu Kush mountains that separated Afghanistan from the regions of Iran and Central Asia. This is your one mark question also, and this is our long answer going on. So there was a potential danger for India. A potential means a very big danger for India, and the Mughal rulers, they always wanted to have control over Hindu Kush, to have control over Kabul and Kandahar, the nearby areas of Hindu Kush. So Kandahar, I told you that it was a bone of contention between the two, and it was a fortress town that came under Humayun. And in 1595, in previous lecture also I told you, it was reconquered by Akbar, and to have control over it so as to save its borders from the other foreigners coming into India and crossing the Hindu Kush. However, in 1613, the Mughal Emperor Jahangir, he sent an envoy, an ambassador to Shah Abbas, that we should be given the control of Kandahar, we should be given the control of this area. But this mission failed. And in the winters of 1622, the Persian armies reconquered, they besieged this fortress town. And this Kandahar and Kabul, they were out of our control, they were out of the control of the Mughals, because in 1622, when the Persian army besieged the fortress town, Mughal army was not prepared for this attack. and because of non-preparedness for the war, they were defeated and this was away from our hands. So this was about the story of Kandahar, the control over Kabul, and Kandahar, the Hindu Kush and the Afghanistan area. Then we come to the next topic, the Ottoman pilgrimage and trade. For a long time, Mughal rulers had trade with the Ottomans. They traded with the mercantiles, with the costly materials, mercantiles from India to the Arabian countries, to the Ottoman Empire. Particularly the two ports of the Red Sea, this is your one mark question, the two ports of the Red Sea, that is Aden and Mukha. Note it down, this is your one mark question. From these ports, whatever trade was done, whatever things were sent, mercantiles were sent to the other countries, and whatever money the Mughal emperors got, they received from it, it was given to the people who were working in the pilgrimage centers of Makkah and Medina, so as to give them incentive, and so as to make them financially sound so that they could look after the work over there and they could maintain all this. However, when Aurangzeb ascended the throne, he saw that some wrong is going on in the trade, and the money that the previous Mughal rulers wanted, that it should be retained by the people who are working in the pilgrimage centers, that is misappropriate, that is not reaching to them. So what Aurangzeb said, that this money should be invested in India only. It should be given to Indians who are working in India, because it is the land as much as the land of God. With this line, I started this lecture today, because I found it that it should be told to you separately, because when we teach in the class, it is a common feature, it's a common phenomenon among the students that Aurangzeb had been orthodox. But in some points, in some of the chronicles, we come to know that in some cases he supported India also and called it as a land of God. Then we will talk about something about Jesuits. Who are Jesuits? They are the Christians, Jesuit priests. You know, they came to India, and we also know that there was a direct sea route to India. When Portuguese Vasco da Gama discovered India through his voyage in 1498 AD. So since then, many Portuguese, many Jesuit priests, Jesuit missionaries, they had been arriving, to India, coming to India time to time, and they were spreading Christianity in the country. And we all know that Akbar was very interested to know about the ideals, about the principles of Christianity, because he was a very liberal ruler and he wanted bring together all the religious philosophies, the Hindus, the Jainas, the Persians, the Iranians, etc. Muslims, obviously. So Jesuit priests, they were welcomed in India. And Akbar sent a mission, to Goa to learn something from the Jesuit priests. You know, when Jesuit priests came to India through the missionaries, they learned Indian languages. And the first languages that they learned was Konkani and Kannada language. And then they began to write about the history of India, many things about the Indian history, many facts about the Mughal history we know through the Jesuit writings. So in Goa, a mission was there with Akbar, and Akbar learned so many things from Jesuit priests. It is said that many Jesuits, they lived with Akbar for about 2 years, and they learned about the working in the Mughal courts, about the working of the Mughal emperors, that how they were looking after the working the administration of India. In the Ibadat Khana in Fatehpur Sikri, note down your one mark question, Fatehpur Sikri, Ibadat Khana, Akbar also started a tradition that the people from all the religions, the philosophers, the scholars of different religions, they will sit together. There were debates, there were discussions, and Akbar was very keen to know about the ideals and about the principles of different religions. We discussed earlier also that Akbar and Abul Fazl, they created a philosophy of sun and light, We talked about the divinity of the kings, divinity of the Mughal emperors, the theory of sun and light that was propagated by Akbar with Abul Fazl. And this light, what does it mean? It means enlightenment. It means the knowledge, the divine power that is given to the Mughal emperors by the God, by the light, so that they are able to rule over the people, rule over a big mass of people in India. And even in the neighboring areas of India, they were known by the people. So the light and sun, this theory went on. So there was a role of Jesuits in the Mughal Empire, and many facts about the Mughal Empire, about the working in the Mughal court, we get from the Jesuit writings. I told you they learned Indian languages, and it helped us to know in writing, in authenticity, about the history of India of that time. So that is the end of your 9th chapter. Just go through all these facts. Maximum questions you will get in board examination. Also from the sources you will get all these things. So prepare yourself very carefully. And we will meet again in any of the next lecture that is very beneficial for you in boards. And till then, have a very good time. Thank you.